Welcome to the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast, where we learn about some success stories and some not so successful stories. But either way, we learn. Each episode, we talk with successful real estate agents and vendors about things they have done to make them successful and some things they did that you might want to avoid. Join us for each episode of the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast with your host, Preston Sandlin.
All right, listeners, thank you for joining the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast. I have one of my favorite people in the whole wide world here today. This is Stormy Benfield. How you doing, Stormy?
Hey, I'm good. Awesome. Beautiful day in the Carolinas.
Yes, I sponsored many of Stormy's classes, and I'm always just like, sometimes I don't know who's teaching the class. As soon as I see Stormy, I immediately just smile because she, I just like Stormy. I don't know how to explain it. She's that type of person. So, but Stormy, you obviously are a real estate instructor, but for people who, you know, there may be some people who watch this that don't know, give us a little background about you. You know, where'd you grow up and how'd you get into real estate? And I mean, you're not only an instructor, you obviously have a successful real estate practice yourself.
So, broker first and foremost, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm from here. I'm from Charlotte. I was born right in Presbyterian Hospital, right in downtown Charlotte, which is really close to where I live now in the Plaza Midwood area. So grew up on in the country at the time in Coolwood, which was the west side. Oh, so yeah. It's kind of fun to go back and sell over there now. Completely different. I went to have my undergrad in business from UNC Charlotte. And that corridor is fun to go to now. Go to the botanical gardens at UNCC now and then take the light rail from UNCC and can go all the way to Uptown Charlotte.
That's
so awesome. See, that's a little bit of, about me. I was with Bank of America for 20 years. Left the banking industry because I got tired of jumping on and off airplanes and jumped into this crazy world that they call real estate.
So now how did you and Darren meet?
How did Darren and I meet? That's really a funny story. Darren and I met because one of my roommates at UNCC when I was a senior, our friend group and his friend group were friends. Okay. So like I didn't meet him. I didn't know him, but he was having a keg party for my roommate. Okay. And back then you could drink at 18, folks. Don't do that now. So I called him and I said, you can't have a keg party. I'm having a keg party for her. And so literally that is the truth of how we met. So I said, all right, I'll tell you what, we'll have it at my house and we'll just split everything. So the next morning, we had a band, had a big party, had a lot of fun, no police officers. It was awesome. We had about 150 people there. It was so much fun. And back in the day, that's in the 80s, folks, that'll tell my age. So we had so much fun. The next day he called and said, hey, can I bring over some drinks, some water, anything? I'm coming over to help clean up. And I'm like, oh, I really like that. And that was it. We started going out and 32 years later, here we are.
That's so cool. Next time I see Darren, I'll be like, hey, Darren, you can't have a cake party. I'm having a cake party. Well, that is cool. And for folks that are listening to this, we actually have a connection because Stormy's son was in my wife's class at St. Gage, right?
Yeah, my son had a huge crush on Miss Luby back in
so
the
did
day.
I
know, right? But yeah, so she was his after school teacher and he only wanted to go to after school because so he could see Miss Luby.
Oh,
so he just, I mean, but your wife is so sweet and so adorable. who wouldn't love her?
Man.
But yeah, I mean, but the kids, man, when she would walk in, it was like they would all be around Meg. So it was fun. So yeah, so we do have that long. Yeah, so I actually knew your wife before I knew you.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, and Meg. So she, what happened was, you know, she was a teacher for, gosh, about 9 years, 9 or 10, and when our first, and she was still teaching after, but when we had the second child, the cost of daycare was as much as she was making. So she stayed home. And then once the kids got school age, she was going to go back to teaching. But by that time, I needed admin. And then she was the admin.
There you go. And now she runs the show. So yeah, there you go.
And we were actually both teachers. That's how we met. But this is your interview. I don't want to get too far off that. But I know you posted something the other day. But anyway, that's how we met. We were both teachers.
Fun.
Awesome. Well, speaking of teachers, you're also a teacher. And
yes.
You have been teaching real estate update, real estate investments, real estate everything, all things real estate. So tell us, you have started a new venture and you're open for business, I think, and are out teaching us. Tell us about it.
So I taught with Bill for 10 years at Superior School of Real Estate. And every year with Bill, you had to write an elective. If you wrote an elective, you could teach with Bill.
Right.
So I've written my share of electives over time. And this last year, I decided, well, let's just take a big step out and go on my own. So I am now teaching for myself. The website is stormybenfield.com. I'm teaching general update, BIC update, my newest elective, which is brand new, only taught it 3 times, property conversion trends. And talk about a timely elective. Wow. So it teaches you how, and investors, to take your home and turn it into revenue. For example, if you have a really long driveway, you live close to the city, mm-hmm. you can rent out your driveway.
Really?
Yeah, I've actually done that. And because if for people to pay $300 to park uptown for a sporting event, they can park their car in my driveway for $20. I can hold 20 cars in my driveway. So it's in my studio, not where I live, in my personal home. But, you know, I make, you know, $600 a weekend for people parking their cars there. What? And all I have to do is go, you know, and it's secure. So everybody's really happy with that. So I teach people about how to, you know, there's YERKs involved. So, the ADLs, like they have in Asheville, the ancillary dwelling units. So we go over a tremendous amount of information that talks about what you can do, without having somebody live in your home. How to use your home in ways people didn't think of before for revenue. And it also is, and this is the timely part, because I never imagined when I wrote it that coronavirus would have happened.
Right.
But the second part of it is how to turn commercial real estate into residential real estate space.
Cool.
So love the elective. It's it has a lot of very timely information.
Awesome. So now I'm assuming you have set days and times.
I do.
Via Zoom. Are you doing it over Zoom?
Right now, we're still restricted via Zoom by the commission. I'm hoping that in May that I'm going to be live. Once the vaccines get out and things calm down, it gets warmer. As it, you know, we saw last year, it kind of subsided a little bit. I'm certainly hoping to be out there without Bill here this year. I'm hoping to do big food trucks and,
oh, nice.
Yeah, I'm hoping to have just huge events. Like I want to do Symphony Park at Freedom Park, and then Preston, you sponsor, and then everybody comes in and they get, they get the food between classes and it'll be prepaid for. So you just walk up and get the food. So there's no money exchange. It'll be outside so we can social distance everybody. We shouldn't have any issues with getting that approved by the commission. Everything's ADA approved. All the bathrooms at Freedom Park are ADA. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm also looking to do a doggy daycare where people can bring their little doggies in. That's a huge one for me. So I'm looking at the Dog Bark on Freedom Drive as one venue. And I'm looking at a few different breweries. And we're going to do the breweries on the 1 to 5. So at 5 o'clock, everybody gets a drink.
Nice.
You survived. Like you survived your continuing ed this year. You deserve a beer.
We need to have ethics when they teach ethics right there.
Yes. Yeah. My next course written is going to, my next course to write will be ethics. It's coming because 2021 is an ethics year. We got to have it done by December 31st.
I took a class with Bill about 10 years ago when they were doing, he did a class out in the sea in Vegas.
And oh, fun.
Yeah, it was the ethics, and then there was beer in the back. Seriously, there was some rule you couldn't drink during the class, but as soon as the class was over, and I'm like,
exactly.
Yeah, I'm here. I'm drinking a beer after having ethics, and I think I'm going to go play in slots.
Yeah, exactly. Why not, right?
Awesome. Well, one more time, what was the, it was stormybenfield.com?
Yeah, it's easy. I wanted to keep it really easy for my name, www.stormybenfield.com. And I have a discount code. So anybody coming in today that is listening to this podcast, the code is SUCCESS. All capital letters.
Success.
All capital letters. Awesome. That is our discount code. Thank you.
Well, I will put in the description that they have to watch the podcast.
Oh, I love that. That's
to get perfect. It, but there will be a code. Well, I have two follow-up questions for you, Stormy. Will you consider, let's say that I'm a broker in charge of an office, and I would like you, I'd really love to have you come in if Cooper, let's assume that we can a couple of months from now. Are you up to doing that sort of thing? Like,
absolutely. Yeah. I have private classes. Absolutely. Yeah, I do. I have all kinds of private classes available for gen up, pick up, property conversion trends, or post 301, post 302, or post 303.
Okay, cool. Now, as a real estate agent, I actually have my license, but it's just so I can have the key way back. I'm curious, you're obviously teaching the update and you've got some electives and things. What, any major, most people probably haven't taken the update yet. Any major change, or what's the big update this year, or what big topics?
So honestly, this particular update course is the hardest update. I've been teaching update courses for 10 years.
Okay.
This is the hardest update course I've ever taught.
Really?
The subject matter in the course is tricky because you have to be careful on delivery. Fair housing is an hour. And people get, you can see in the climate that we're in today that's a very... that's a very tricky conversation. And a lot of conversation is around court cases that are coming up. For example, one of the big questions, and we'll see what the lawmakers decide, is fair housing vouchers. Obviously, we don't have enough for affordable housing. We need more affordable housing. We all know that. Yeah. But can you, as a landlord, can you in North Carolina mandate that a landlord use specific vouchers, that everybody plays by the same rules? Because currently they don't. You either do have it or you don't have it. Very controversial. So the other big topic in this one, boy, let me tell you what, this one really jacks people up, and it is assistive animals versus therapy animals versus service dogs. And there's about, it's just a little over an hour in the update course on understanding that in North Carolina, assistive animals and service animals have equal stature.
Okay.
And that's based on the HUD Secretary, Housing for Urban Development. So because he wrote that into legislation, and he wrote that back in FHEO in 2010, and they have now updated it and amended it to 2021. So what the complaints that come into the Real Estate Commission over the last year, 60% of the complaints are coming in because we as brokers, we as property managers are not allowing people reasonable accommodations for dogs and fair housing. 60% of the complaints are on those two topics. Wow. So the commission really hit those hard this year. It's a good course, but it's a tough course to get through. There's so many new rules. And with all of that information, it's a packed course this year.
Wow. Yeah, I have some, we have some rental properties, and it's a catch 22 for us, because you know me, I'm a dog person. You probably heard them barking in the background, but rental properties.
Really? You got a dog on your shirt. I wouldn't know.
Yeah,
you're a dog
exactly.
person. Yeah.
But rental properties too. But that's like, you know, you got to think about what kind of dog is it? And, you know, and the damage that
right.
scanner does do. And then also we will not allow any type of aggressive breed because I just don't want, I don't want a dog that the breed has killed somebody. I just
the liability.
I mean, I don't know if that's fair housing or falls under that, but that's just my, I won't allow that type, any of those type of dogs. I mean, I love those type of dogs. I mean, I love all dogs, and I think it's how you take care of them. But I just, like you said, I'm not taking that liability.
Yeah. But then so you can imagine if you got 50 people in a room and everybody has their own ideas.
Yeah.
That you've got to be a good, you have to really be able to control that. So, I love dogs too. I love cats too. So I love animals. A matter of fact, in my office, which is my studio, one of my rental properties I turned into my studio, I have a little mouse. We've caught two mouses. And so I have the cute little mouse traps, and we caught the little mouse, and it's cute. It's brown with a little white belly. And so we took it to the local park nearby, gave it some water and let it out. So I wouldn't want to use, I really do love animals.
Me too. But I also know too, I've seen some videos where people lost their mind because somebody was in a restaurant with not everybody does love dogs or cats. I get that.
And so cultural too, in North Carolina, when you look at North Carolina specifically, you go, you know, in Uptown Charlotte, you really don't see a lot in the summertime. You don't see a lot of dogs on the patios while people are eating. But when you go to Asheville, Blowing Rock, Boone, Banner Elk, it is common.
Oh yeah. Well, you know, that's Meg's big thing when we go out to eat in the summer.
Oh yeah.
We have to find a place that we figured it out. Like if they have a patio that doesn't have any kind of like fence or anything like
sure.
that, you can have a dog. But if it's like a patio that has like some sort of enclosure, you got to ask about it, you know, but I get it.
So I realize that you're interviewing me, but I have to ask you, how did you guys survive the Clemson game the other day?
It was painful. Well, it was painful. That may be where I wound up getting the COVID too, because we went to a bar in Hickory Tavern. We went down in South Carolina because the game was at 8 o'clock, which, you know,
right.
10 o'clock curfew now. So we went down to Indian Land. Oh, storm. As soon as we drove up, I mean, we're walking, it's a sea of red. It was like 75 Ohio State people there.
Wow.
Yeah. I was like, this isn't South Carolina, right? Is anybody still in Ohio? Seems like they're all here. But
wow, that's crazy.
Oh my gosh.
And y'all get out in your orange gear.
Yeah. Oh, I was decked out, but it was me, a couple friends, and my daughters and their friends, and they were all wearing Clemson jerseys, but we were definitely minority. But most of them were pretty nice. There were three that were a little, Clemson sucks.
Aww.
You're winning, dude. You're winning. All right. Be happy. But so what happened was, they were all right. I mean, but like I kept at halftime, pretty soon after halftime, it was pretty obvious that it was not going. And I kept telling Megs, like, bro, you want to go? You want to go? And I'm like, well, I got to wait till Clemson does something good and then we'll leave, because I don't want to leave like I tucking my tail between my legs.
Right, right.
We can leave on a good note. Well, I had to wait for a long time. It took a while. So they'll be back, though. They'll be back.
They're always strong. They're always strong.
They got the kid from Weddington, Will Shipley. Remember that name? Will,
yes.
We've watched that kid for 3 years. He is phenomenal. I think he's going to be the next Christian McCaffrey. You watch.
Whoa, that's big words. Wow, that's big words.
Go back. So the date of this is January 2021. So it's dated that I'm calling.
You heard it now.
Yeah, Will Shipley will be the next big star at Clemson.
Wow, that's awesome news.
But
is your kids all still in, are they remote? Have they gone back to college?
Yes, Sarah Margaret's going back. She she took a rifle class, and she texted me the other day, Daddy, I shot three guns. It was so much fun. And she took a bow and arrow class last semester. So I'm like, I'm pretty proud, man. I want her to be able to do that stuff.
That's fantastic.
I know. She's like, you think I should take it? Daddy, it's all boys. And I'm like, well, honey, I mean, why do you think I took teaching?
Exactly. And is this her junior year?
It is.
So I remember, Preston, when she was leaving and you were having panic attacks about her leaving for her freshman year. And you're like, oh, I don't know if I can handle this. This is going to be rough. And I said, oh, don't worry. They come home.
Yeah.
And now that you're 3 years in, do you see what I said? They come home.
Yeah, definitely.
You're probably ready for them to go back to college now. That's where, by the junior year, that's where I was.
And I'm ready for, I mean, I love them to death, but I'm ready for them to get off the payroll.
Good luck.
But I know. But fortunately, she's doing packaging science, which supposedly, and I think she's got she's trying to get this internship. But anyway, the word on the street is the jobs are that, like, there's a high chance of them getting a good job, supposedly. So,
well, that's good for her. That's better than the inventory that we've got from a housing perspective, let me tell you. I think that that as a whole, the Big Charlotte market is really in a hole from an inventory standpoint. Have you heard how low our inventory is?
No, I was curious. I saw Brian Pate, your buddy, and both our buddies. He gave the Raleigh MLS, which is similar.
He does.
Said they were down below 3,000.
Yeah, well, I don't know what our exact number is, but we're about 45 days worth of inventory.
Really?
And a healthy market is 6 months. So we're way lower than where we need to be.
And I bet if you cut out the high end, you know, it would even be less than that. Because anything, you know, in the $300,000-$400,000 range or less, it just flies off.
Gone. Yeah, 750 and up, you're still sitting a little bit.
Awesome. Well, not awesome. I mean, it's better than the opposite, but it would be better if we had more supply. Well, speaking of real estate, that brings me to some questions. I hope we can, since you are, before you were a real estate instructor and you still are a successful real estate agent, and a lot of real estate agents listen and watch the podcast, a couple of real estate questions for you. Is that okay?
Yeah, I'm ready. Go ahead.
All right. So what do you think about, Stormy, what do you think about coaching? Have you done coaching, received coaching, gave coaching? What's your opinion of it? Do you recommend it for others?
I think that if you're, let me go back to football, you go back to your to your guy from Weddington, Will. Mm-hmm. Does Will have a coach, do you think?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, like a strength coach too, or some sort of special.
Exactly. I use it, and I look at coaching in that way. You know, Tiger Woods, does he have a coach? Sure he does. Does Will have a coach? Sure he does. We're all better when we're coached. And coaching does a lot of things. It's good for accountability. It's good for showing you things that you don't know, techniques that you wouldn't have come upon on your own. So I'm pro coaching. I was the first productivity coach at Keller Williams Ballantyne, first productivity coach in North Carolina. So I had a coach. I've been a coach. I'm a fan. If you are a coach, you're hard to coach. So I was told, but I mean, it's true, but it's the accountability part of it is really big. And I'm a fan. I think if for somebody who's getting into this industry, especially in the beginning, I'd much rather people put their money in coaching than buying leads.
Cool. Well, that's actually, I'm coming up on that question too. But to follow up on that, if I was just starting in real estate and I'm listening to you, and what all right, so I think I need coaching. How would I go about finding the right coach, you think? What how should someone do that?
Yeah, so I get asked this question almost every time I'm teaching a provisional broker class. And I think the key is to, just like you, how do you find the right automobile? How do you find the right house? You've got to interview at least three.
Yeah.
You know, ask your broker in charge, ask your instructor, get names and information from people, and go ahead and interview two or three. Until you find the one that feels good, that you have a good connection with.
Awesome. No, that's perfect. That's a great answer. What do you think is best lead generation, and what's your opinion of paying for leads?
Okay, so I have been in the real estate business now for 14 years, and I have failed big on lead generation so many times.
Right.
I will tell you that I have bought leads before. And what I have found for me, out of 100 leads that you get from purchasing leads, my ability to turn that into revenue is only 8%. So that's for me, I found that was a really tough way to manage it. I am a fan of grassroots. I go back to the Tom Hopkins method of finding a neighborhood that fits for people and literally working that neighborhood or farming that neighborhood, door knocking, door hanging, mailers, things that are going to their homeowners association meetings, going to the any type of meetings that are around that neighborhood, and really doing some old-fashioned grassroots efforts.
Awesome. What's the best real estate advice you ever got? Who gave it to you?
It was my first broker in charge. That's a great question. And Winona Van Winkle, and she set me down, and she was not one to mince words either. She set me down and she said, you know, I'm going to give you some advice in real estate, and if you believe me, you'll carry it with you. And it was the best advice, and I swear by it today. She said, if you are a nice person and you do things professionally and you know your contracts, you'll have like clients, super nice clients. If, however, you are a drama person and you inflict drama into the transaction, all of your transactions will be laden with drama. If you are an asshole, you will attract asshole clients.
Wow.
And she couldn't have been more spot on 14 years later.
Wow.
And that is the truth.
Wow, that's good. I like that. I can see that. That's really good.
Hello, I'm Bill Gallagher with Superior School of Real Estate, and I'm here with Preston Sandlin of Home Inspection Carolina. Preston, I've always liked your style, especially those pants. And also, I've been interested in the home inspection business for a long time.
Well, Bill, that's ironic. I've always admired your style, and I've always admired your ability to educate these fine folks for sometimes 4-8 hours a day. I wish that I could do what you do.
Hey, Preston, wouldn't it be cool if we switched? Preston, we sure got what we wished for, buddy.
We sure did. And now that you're the expert, Bill, I mean, you are wearing the pants. And I'm the instructor and the educator. Tell us what Home Inspection Carolina is doing these days to make the home buying process easier for realtors and home buyers.
Well, Preston, all our home inspection reports now are online for the real estate agent and the client to review the report online and to be able to create a repair list basically online by either clicking repair, accept, monetary compensation, and once they prepare the request, they can then press email, text, or print right then.
You mean it's all automated, Bill?
Absolutely. We are high tech.
Wow. What else is Home Inspection Carolina doing different these days?
Well, Preston, we're training our home inspectors to be non-alarmist. We are training them to put things into perspective and to simplify the message for the hopeful homeowner.
Non-alarmist is key, Bill. You remember those days of the 100-page reports and those 3-ring binders that would just go on and on and on, la, 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 la. Thank you for being a good non-alarmist.
And Preston, one more thing. We fix the small stuff for free. Do you remember when home inspectors always put those little nitpicky items on those reports?
Oh, bless their hearts.
Well, at Home Inspection Carolina, if we can fix it in 5 minutes or less, we do it for free. We're better with a caulk gun than a keyboard any day. We just fix it.
You mean there's no cost for this, Bill?
Preston, it's free.
Wow.
Well, Preston, these pants really are a catch.
Well, Bill, I've enjoyed wearing the suit, but I don't think I could wear it every day because I got to fix the small stuff for free, and I don't want to ruin a good suit.
Preston, it's been a lot of fun flipping the switch.
What do you think about scripts? Do you believe in scripts? Do you use scripts? What's your feeling about scripts?
I think if you are a new agent and or a non, or if you're not a scripts can be great for some people. They never worked for me because I just like to talk too much. Unlike you, Preston, I always got in trouble in school for talking too much. You know what I'm saying? It's just, you know, because it's just our personalities. Yeah. So I can use a script to a degree, but to me, a script feels like a script. So I can follow the baseline of it. But if you're not confident, it's a phenomenal way to get your words the way you want your words to be.
Right. You know, I mean, I'm a home inspector. I have a real estate license, but I've obviously been around real estate agents for half my life, you know.
Sure.
For me, it's like scripts, I think, are a good starting point, but eventually maybe you internalize it to where you don't really need it and you can call audibles. And I mean, I guess I know some people swear by them. I just never wanted, for me personally, to sound robotic, you know.
Right. Me too. You know,
they say this, I say this, they say that. But I think if I was just totally, I mean, you know, you call a FSBO and, you know, you better have something ready to say.
Yeah,
you know,
for sure.
And, you know, obviously there's a couple of ways this could go and you better have. But I always wanted to be able to put my own, this is me talking, this is me, you know, but I guess a script, it's kind of like working out. you know, if when you first go to the gym, first workout, it's good probably to have a workout that I've seen, you know, people write them down in a notebook and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
But after a while, you do it, you know, 30 years.
You kind of want to switch it up.
Yeah, it's all up here.
Yeah.
But starting out, it started there. Same sure. thing for women's groups. So, all right, I got a question for you. This is for real estate agents' benefit. You're selling a nice, let's say $1.5 million. And how do you answer the, you know, oh, man, why should I pay you 3%? You know, they wanted you to take a reduction. What's your best response to when the client are in that negotiation of take a reduction for your fee? Say that right.
So Preston, you want me to cut my commission and instead of you paying me the 3%, how do you want to compensate the buyer's agent? Oh, you want the buyer's agent to get the full 3%. Isn't that interesting that you're willing to pay the buyer's agent who is negotiating against you the full 3%, but yet me, who I am representing you in your best interest, you want me to take a cut. Now let's think that through. If I were to agree to that, I would also be agreeing to not represent you because I would already be taking a cut in my commission. Why wouldn't I bring you a lower offer than what my expectation is? I'm going to earn every dollar of my 3% and more. Trust me. So you brought me in the door for a reason. Now let's get to work.
That's good. I've never heard anybody say that, but that's fantastic. But you're going to pay the opposing counsel again, going against you full price, but you're not going to pay me. I've heard that. And then the one, you know, where, what is it? If I immediately took a cut in mine, do you think I'm going to look out for you if I'm not
exactly
tough in what I, you know, so awesome. Well, and if they still want it after that, that's going to be a drama. That's going to be a drama.
Exactly.
Drama ones you were talking about. What advice would you give somebody going into the real estate business today? Brand new agent, just starting out. And they come to you, Stormy, what advice do you have for them?
Yeah, and I really, as an instructor, and I'll plug my school again, stormybenfield.com. But, as an instructor, I get asked this question, I mean, at least 5 times during every provisional broker class. So the big advice I would say is stay calm, work really hard, and interview 5 brokerage companies that you have an interest in. And when you narrow it down to 2, now this is pre-COVID, go sit in their multi-purpose room or training room, whatever it is, sit in each one for a full day. And look at what's going on around that office. Are you having people talking all the time or people hustling? If you've got people hustling, they're too busy to have chit chat, right? You want to be in an environment where everybody is hustling and moving, and they may be nice and say, hello, how you doing, as they're walking to the copy machine, or as they're, they might say hello as they're bringing a client into a conference room. But you want to see that momentum, that energy that matches the new agent's energy. You may not everybody's energy is the same. I have super high energy. You have super high energy. Not everybody has that. So find that office that matches your energy and what feels good to you. And if you sit there for a day and in one, and then you sit there in the day in the other one, once you've narrowed it down to 2, at the end of the second day, you'll know where you need to be.
Awesome. Awesome. I love it. Now, obviously, you've met a lot of agents over time, and, you know, And I guess let me set the table for this question. I do a lot of new agent orientation, you know, the brand new agents. And as I'm looking out, it's almost like I know in my head, you know, that before COVID, now it's all virtual, but, you know, I'm looking out, there's like 100 new, you know, they're taking their course they have to take to get their key and all that. And I think Cindy does something with them, but I get to, you know, I pay for my little 5 minutes or whatever I get. But I'm sitting there in my mind going, running the numbers. Out of this group of 100, there'll probably be 4 or 5 that will be fantastic. You know, they'll wind up, there'll probably be a certain number that'll be okay. And there's going to be a lot that just wash out completely that won't be doing real estate. You know, it's not an easy, you know, it's not easy.
It's not easy.
No. So obviously we've all known some agents that were successful, even ultra successful. And some that wash out or are just not quite successful. What do you think the common ingredient is? I mean, and I know there's different ways to be successful, but what ingredient is it, do you think, that those ones that are successful, ultra successful, share that maybe not as much with the ones that wash out?
Systems. You got to have your systems in place. You got to have a good database, a good contact database for following up. You've got to not be able to be, you have to be able to pick up the phone and call people. Personal relationships is key to everything in life, in my opinion. You know, I have agents that'll say, oh, but I don't want to call people. Well, wait, you're in real estate. You have to call people. When you woke up today, your salary was zero. Yeah. Your only opportunity to make money today is if you call somebody. Oh yeah, no, I'm gonna send out a few texts instead, right? And you hear this. And so, you know, do you have a database? No, I'm not worried about a database right now. I'm gonna keep it all on an Excel spreadsheet. So people that will resist what has been proven over and over and over, I think that really sets people apart. Not trying to reinvent the wheel. In other words, come right in and use the systems that are available to them.
You know, I've got a, Stormy, I got a really good friend that's a commercial real estate agent. He's really good. And we're really good friends, like couple, like we do stuff with him and our kids are friends. And I've been with him. He has a thing. He calls 30 people a day, every single day. Well, you know, not maybe not on Sunday or something, but, you know, we've been with him at the beach or something. And he sits down and he told me that he carves out like 3 hours a day and just calls 30 people, you know, and, you know, and people he called before, he has sort of a CRM. I'm like, wow, that's pretty strong, you know, and he follows up with them and stuff. And he says, you just got to do it every day, you know? And
I was like, every day. It's yeah. Everything. It's everything. This morning, I've called 28 people so far this morning.
Wow. I guess, you know, I wonder if I should start doing that with home inspection, apply that, especially now in COVID, because I can't really go to office.
But here's what's interesting, Preston. I didn't call him for real estate. I called him to invite him to come to my school.
Yeah.
So these were provisional brokers that I'm calling, inviting to my school. People don't know me. I'm grassroots again. I mean, I look at my school just like, yes, my revenue stream, my brokerage business is strong, but I'm starting over from scratch on real estate. So I don't expect that my real estate school is going to instantly be successful. I've got to pick up the phone. I've got to work the phones every single solitary day to make sure people know who I am again. So when it's a startup business, I'm with those brand new brokers. I'm a brand new school. I have the belief that I have to work hard every day to go get those people. So I'm right there with them.
You ever heard that saying? I've heard it a couple different ways where it's like every day in the jungle, there's I might mess it up here, but there's a lion that knows, like, if he can't, if he can't outrun the slowest gazelle, he'll starve. Or something right. Like that. And every day in the jungle, there's a gazelle that knows that if it can't outrun the other slowest gazelle, it'll get eaten.
That's right.
And it says, whether you're a lion or gazelle, when the sun comes up, you better be running.
You better be running. That's absolutely the truth.
It is true. It's true. It's true.
And you know, and that, and I don't, you know, again, I am thankful for everybody that signed up for my classes so far, but I'm telling you, it is, you will see me hustling every single day to get people to come and join the school and give them the best service they can possibly get while they're there. Cause I love the students. I love nurturing. I love helping them. So that's just of my nature. That's the reason I did it I've been doing it for 10 years. You were a school teacher. You get it. People who do that type of career, obviously it fulfills some type of nurturing within me. Right. So and then you go back and look at real estate, right? Which do I like better, listings or buyers? So that's a big question, right? I love the buyers. I have since the day I got into the business. Now Bill Gallagher will tell you listings are the last. I've had to learn how to be a good listing agent, but I like the hunt kill of finding that right house for that buyer, putting in that offer and getting it accepted. To me, that is so much fun. Listings are a lot more front end work. And if there's something that goes wrong, who's to blame? Always the listing agent. So I had to become a study of how to become a good listing broker. And so I went to the top producers in my office at the time and said, hey, can I watch you? I won't say a word. Just let me watch you. Right. And so I sat and watched them set up their appointments with their sellers for follow-up. And I watched what they did and I listened. And so it doesn't come natural to me to be a good listing agent, but I have learned that behavior now after 14 years, but it was a learned behavior. So, you know, that's one of the big things too. You don't have to be good at everything. You just have to be a study of your craft.
Nice. I like it. And that leads into, I got two more questions. Then we're going to have some fun. Lightning round. And I appreciate, I hope I'm not holding you up.
You're getting valuable
nuggets here. Speaking of listing presentations. Now, you know, ideally, you know, they tell everybody, have three agents come and give you a listing presentation. So if you're one of the three, what does Stormy Benfield do to differentiate herself and make sure that seller chooses her over the other two?
I want to be the first agent in the door. So I will try to find out when the other two appointments are and try to set mine up ahead of time if I can. Okay. So for me, that because most people go with the first agent that they speak to.
Really?
So yes, the stats are high on that, somewhere in the 74% range.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So I try to be the first agent in the door if I possibly can for a listing. And the second thing is, we all have a great presentation at this point in the game. I mean, I feel like after 14 years, everybody has a good listing presentation, package, professional photos, all the things that you do. But it's closing. You have to close them. Can we go ahead and get the picture started today? Would you like to start the staging consultation today as well? Did I meet your needs? Are we ready to sign the listing paperwork? So it's really that last sentence in closing the deal.
That's good. And that kind of makes me understand now why maybe 70% of the first person who can do that the best might call the other two and just say, "Hey."
I've had that happen throughout my career where they call the other agents and say, I'm all set. Thank you."
Oh, wow. That's good. That's good. All right. Last real question. Then we'll get to some real quick fun stuff. What now, remember, this is a G-rated show. all your years in real estate, what is the craziest or weirdest thing you've ever seen or heard of happen in a real estate transaction or just real estate related?
I'll say the oddest thing that I had, and it was a closing in probably my third year in the business. And it was back in the 2009 market. And there was an investor that I was representing, and we were in the attorney's office, and the attorney is going through the paperwork. He's going through the paperwork, and all of a sudden he says, and of course you have a non-marketable title. And then he went right to the next, very quick, lightning round quick, went to the next piece of paper. And I said, wait, what? Let's back up a second. And so they were literally going to sell my client a house with a non-marketable title. He was going to close the deal.
Lien on it or something? What is a non-marketable?
It was non-marketable. It was one of those robo deals where it was illegally foreclosed upon. And then it was put back on the market for sale. But so there were so many flaws on the title. It was a non-marketable title. Couldn't pass by general warranty deed. So I said, whoa, let's stop the closing. And so, I mean, I'm just like, so my ears are still so green 3 years in. I have no idea what I'm doing.
They were lucky that you caught that for them.
Well, I mean, I'm listening, right? And I'm like, whoa, let's stop the closing. Five attorneys later, 3 hours later, it turns out that was an illegal closing. And if my client had bought it, he would not have been able to resell that property. So that was the weirdest thing that I've ever experienced. Later, that attorney was disbarred.
Ooh, I think I might know who that attorney is. But
I think you might.
I might. But there's other stories about if it's who I think.
Yes.
All right. Well, we're going to play some this or that. But before that, first, I want to check your music knowledge, Stormy. See if you can finish. I'm going to play a song. And then I'll cut and see if you can finish the lyrics. All right, you ready?
Are you doing 80s music?
A little further than that. Can you hear it?
A little bit.
Maybe not finish the lyrics, but there was a reason. Do you know who that is and what the name of the song is?
No. Ring, ring goes the bell. But I've heard the song before.
School Days. Chuck Berry. Yeah, I was trying to find something that related to school. And I was like, well, I didn't want to do Hot for Teacher. That might be a little unprofessional or something. So then I was like, School Days, and then I was trying to get something related to your school or something.
Oh, and I play a lot of music. I play a lot of music before class, during breaks, and after class. I'm a big music fan. So, yeah, Lynn Elder and
I. Actually, I was looking on your profile to see. I was trying to find something to see if you had like a specific band or something that you like. You probably like a little bit of everything, I imagine.
I do. But I like classical, love 80s music. So big Styx fan, big Aria fan.
Mr. Roboto, I got your reference. Right?
Yeah. There you go.
I should have asked before the interview what your, I would have pulled that. All right. This or that. So I'm going to give you two things and you choose one of them. Dog or cat? Dog or cat?
Cat.
Netflix or YouTube?
YouTube.
Phone call or text?
Both.
Cardio or weights?
Cardio.
iOS or Android?
I'm sorry?
iOS or, you know, like Apple or Android?
Apple.
Football or basketball?
SEC football, ACC basketball.
There you go. Would you, in basketball, if you followed a little bit, Michael or LeBron?
Michael.
What's worse, to have to do laundry or have to do dishes?
Laundry.
Jogging or hiking?
Hiking.
Tennis shoes or sandals?
Sandals.
sandals. She said flip flops. Online shopping or shopping in a store?
I prefer shopping in store.
Me too. Me too. I just like to be able to see it, touch it, you know, look at it. Car or truck?
Car.
Blue or red?
Red.
Money or free time?
Money.
Amusement, a day at an amusement park or a day at the beach?
Beach.
That one, I'm going to save that one till last. Beach or mountains?
Mountains.
Yeah, you teach it up in Asheville. Yeah. Winter or summer?
Summer.
Mac or PC?
Mac.
Sweater or hoodie?
Hoodie.
When you're sleeping, fan or no fan?
No fan.
So the most important one, toilet paper, over or under?
Oh, there's, it's got to be over.
That's what everybody says. Like, what is it? What is it? Mullets or beards or something like
that? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hang on one second, throwing my other question fell out.
Sure.
All right. Well, awesome. Well, tell us something that most people don't know about you, Stormy. We just got like two questions left. You've done an awesome job.
Thanks. Most people don't know about me is that I am the baby of five girls. That's where the name Stormy comes from. And it is a legit birth given name. It's not a nickname.
Yeah, I know when you, one time you were teaching a class, I don't know, about a year or two ago, it was when all that stuff was going down with Stormy Daniels.
Oh, yeah. And I would use that as my icebreaker.
Stormy Daniels.
Sorry to disappoint you, but you came to the wrong class if you came for the Stormy Daniels show.
There you go. Do you have what weird or funny skill do you have?
What weird or funny skill do I have? Huh.
Or is there something that you're like, some odd skill that you have, like, I'll give you mine. People ask me that, I was asked that. That's where I get the question from. And I said, you know, my dad was into old cars. So when I was a kid, everywhere we went, he drilled me on like, see that boy? That's a 64 Cadillac. You know what the difference between 64 and 65 is? It's a little chrome thing. This was my whole childhood. So my weird skill is, any older car, I can tell you the exact year and model. I can't do anything with that. I can't monetize it, but it's all that years of I don't know what I can do with that. But
that's awesome. I think probably the one weirdo thing that people wouldn't think about with me is I love to dance. I will dance into the kitchen in the morning when people aren't around. Like if I have the house to myself, I blast the music and I'm dancing around as I'm doing laundry. So I really love to listen to music and just dance. There's something about music and dancing for me that is freedom. Yeah. It takes your mind off everything else that's going on and puts you in a different place. Now, not to show my age too much, but I know that you and I have some memories of Plum Crazy back in the day.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right. So I mean, that was one of my big fun spots as a child. Another big thing with me that my dad drilled in me all the time is no drinking and driving. So not even one drink. So I'm a big, I was the big kid all the times going to all the clubs, I always drove and I was never drinking. So I didn't have I really didn't drink any alcohol at all until I was 35 years old.
Wow.
I moved to the suburbs and found wine.
There you go.
And I've made up for lost time.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that. You know, backing up to your first thing about dancing, you made me think about something that I hadn't thought of in years. One of my buddies, my best friend in high school, Rick Burrow, we're still friends, but you know, I like have different best friends at different
times. Sure.
I remember him telling me, I remember him telling me, he played guitar, he was really into music. He says, if you want a recipe to have a good day every day, and I said, well, how do you do that? He said, if you turn on music and dance every morning, you will have a good day. And I was like, true. Maybe I need to try that. It's like, he said, it's impossible to have a bad day if you turn on music. So I might give that a shot tomorrow morning.
It's true. And people do ask me, how do you come in smiling all the time? How are you so happy? Well, I mean, you start your day off with music and dancing. How do you go wrong?
Yeah, well, and you know, and I'll leave you with the fact that, you know, my father, the one I was telling you about, was a mortician, and not to be morbid, actually the opposite. I mean, it was very obvious to me from an early age. We're all gonna die.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, not to be morbid, but my point in that is life is just too short to just, I just don't have time for the negativity. And I don't even watch the news anymore. I mean,
me either.
Bits and pieces, but you know, the news' job is to outrage people.
It is.
That's their job. And then they have a commercial for Paxil or, you know, antidepressant or life insurance.
Sure.
I'm like, you know, let's what? I'm just not falling for it. And then in the news will make you think that people don't get along, that nobody gets along. But honestly, if you go to the gym or you go out and meet people, most people I know obviously there's a few jerks here and there, but most people are like, they get along a lot better than the news gives them credit for.
I 100% agree with all of that. Yes. And I think that, again, goes back to what my broker in charge says, if you're a happy person, you're going to attract happy people.
Absolutely.
And yeah, I mean, it's that like is very attractive.
Awesome. Well, we would like, and Story would like, to attract some happy people to some classes.
Yes.
And one more time, before we let her go, she has a code for you guys.
Yes, success. You
get a discount. So go to, is it stormybenfield.com?
Mm-hmm. Try to make it nice and easy. StormyBenfield, my name. www.stormybenfield.com. And your discount code is success. All caps, SUCCESS.
Awesome. And can they, if they have any questions or anything, can they message you via that website?
Message me, call me, send me an email, however you like to communicate. And I would love to answer any questions you have about anything in real estate and anything about the school and any upcoming classes that are out there.
Are you also going to, probably should ask you this before I put you on the spot. Are you going to be like available, like if people have questions like about the update and stuff like that, can they email you? Or are you okay with that?
Absolutely. And, you know, and right now in our repertoire, we got, again, the update courses, an elective. We have code of ethics coming, post 301, 2, and 3. I don't do pre-licensing. I've been asked if I'm going to offer that. So I'm thinking the answer is going to be yes, and I'm looking at Q2 next year.
Okay, cool. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Stormy. And we're going to see you Friday at 10 on Listing and Lattes, right?
Yes, sir. You got to send me the link.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you so much, Stormy.
Thank you, Preston.
I will.
It was a lot of fun.
All right. Have a good one. I'll see you Friday, all right?
I'll see you Friday. Thanks so much.
All right. Thank you.
Bye.
You've been listening to the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast with your host, Preston Sandlin. Join us on the next episode where we'll be talking to a successful agent or vendor about the right things to do and the wrong things you should avoid. Join us on the next episode of the Successful Real Estate Broker Podcast.